What's up? This is Rebel Radio.
What up? What up? This is DJ Newmark.
This is Peanut Butter Wolf.
It's your boy. It's okay.
Keep checking out Rebel Radio.
Rebel Radio.
This is Rebel Radio.
We're in the place right here. Rebel Radio is going down.
Would you say Rebel Radio?
Oh, wait. Let's do it again.
Rebel Radio.
What's up, Rebels? Welcome back to Rebel Radio, the weekly show where I bring you the rebels who are shaping our culture. This week, I bring you our very first ever quarantine edition. It's the first episode in almost 5 years that was not face-to-face. We're now set up in the home studio doing video chat. I got to tell you, I don't love it. I love sitting in the room with somebody and really digging into their story. It's just not the same over video, over phone, whatever. But like everything else in 2020, we're going to do the best we can. So I'm excited to share this one with you. This one is also part of our Artwork Rebels series that we do in partnership with Gorilla One and my co-host Eddie Donaldson. If you're not familiar with Eddie and Gorilla One, he's been doing amazing work for 20 plus years, bringing art into corporate environments, into the streets, helping artists from the streets build their businesses. It's great stuff, and you should check him out online. And our guest today is David Flores, who I discovered over a decade ago. Well, I didn't discover him. He was already doing his thing. But I learned about David over a decade ago through the work that he did for us for Scion. And David's known around the world for the graphics that he does for skate decks, as well as for his beautiful large-scale murals. He paints people like Bob Marley, David Bowie, Salvador Dali, Frida Kahlo, Nelson Mandela. The list goes on and on. Dave's stuff is dope. You definitely want to check it out. We catch up with Dave in his studio in Ojai, and he talks a little bit about being surrounded by nature and what that does to his creativity, to his artistic process. And we also dig into some of his stories of how he got to be who he is now. I hope you'll enjoy it. Let's get into it right after our EDM.com track of the week. That was Kev Mo with Demons, the EDM.com track of the week. If you like that one, get over to EDM.com and check out more new music. And let's get into the interview with Dave Flores. Well, what's up, man? I appreciate you making time for this.
Thank you. Appreciate it for having me on.
Yeah. No, I love your art. Always have. I think I learned about you from the Scion stuff that we were doing. And, you know, when Eddie brought your name up, I thought, let's talk to this dude.
All right.
Yeah, so how do you guys know each other?
Eddie goes back to about 2011 when I met Eddie. We had a little gallery and we were just shut the shit back and forth.
Yeah.
But I've known about Eddie for a real long time through my friend Danny Boy. Like, he's like, oh, you got to hook up with Eddie Donaldson and none of that. And I heard Eddie's name around for like a long time before I actually met him.
For sure.
He's also famously in a House of Pain video.
Eddie's the center of a lot of things.
He's the BGP
House of Pain videos.
Is that right?
Yeah. So, yeah, just shooting the shit at your gallery. I think that was mostly it, huh? And just like.
Yeah, we met through Danny Boy. We definitely met through Danny Boy, but I knew who you were before that.
Oh, right on.
Nice. Well, I'm excited to talk about your journey a little bit and some of what you're up to now. But let me start you off with a random question. You remember the first record you ever bought?
It was a CD. It was a cassette tape.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah. What was it?
What was it?
MC Shan.
Oh, hell yeah.
Wow.
The Bridge.
Remember Shan? Yep.
Nice.
And then I was like hell bent on collecting because I was in the collecting. Like whatever I got, whatever it was a cassette, Hot Wheels, whatever it was, I just got into them. I just started collecting them. So I got into collecting hip-hop. I'd buy them. I didn't even know, like, who the artist was, and I would just buy them.
You just like the artwork?
Let's say I had a Kangol hat. I go, oh, this is the guy. I'd buy him.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I just got into the albums and the artwork. Back in the cassette days, this is like the 80s, I guess.
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, people sleep on cassettes, man, because, you know, the sound wasn't that good or whatever. But, you know, just having that.
Just having the cassette, having the little action in your hand, you know what I mean? Going, like, just getting it.
Yeah.
Just having it, having the music, being part of whatever was being held in that little, like, you know, that little cassette thing. That, oh, there's the art, the music, there's names in here, the music was everything, you know?
So, Yeah, that's right. And then how'd you get started making art?
I've always drawn my whole life. My friends were turning pro skater, you know? Like, I lived in Santa Barbara, and they were turning pro, and I wasn't really good enough to be pro or nothing. I hung out with them. They were rippers, all of them. I was kind of good, I guess. I wasn't that good. I was good enough to hang out, but I wouldn't. And they go, Dave, I'm turning pro. You know, my friend Ricky Higgins. I need a board graphic. And I did one, then I did two, and then three, and that's how it all started, skateboarding.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And was there a moment when you kind of realized that was going to be your career? Or did it just happen like...
There was a moment when I realized it was going to be my career. It was when Clean Skateboards had started up. This is the first graphics I ever done professionally, get paperwork for a company called Shorties, right? Rest in peace, Tony Bulis. He just passed away, actually, real recently.
He did. Rest in peace.
And I didn't really look at it as a career because it was kind of just doing graphics for my friends, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I went and did, like, not an interview, but I went and, like, hung out with these other guys in L.A. from this company called Clean Skateboards back in the day. And they're like, yeah, can you do some board graphics for us? And I got, this little advance check for, like, $400 just to start doing graphics for them. And that was when I realized, like, oh, shit, I'm not going to do this for, like, you know what I mean, for money and for, like, living and shit, you know?
Yeah.
I was driving. We rode back to Santa Barbara from LA, and I was laying down in the back of a pickup truck in the bed, freezing my balls off of my friend. And we were just like, "We got money." $400 was like so much, dude. It was great.
I mean, that's an amazing feeling, right?
Yeah, but that was the day. That was the night I remembered. That was like my first like check.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. Yeah.
And was the thinking at that time was it just skate graphics or like? Did you have this vision of, you know, everything that you wanted to do?
I've always had this, like, idea in my head that whatever I did, it would turn into something more. Mm-hmm. So I was banking on the fact that, not the fact, but the hope that, you know, skateboard graphics would lead to some sort of big design job in New York City. I had all these ideas in my head. I didn't really know what I wanted to do, you know what I mean? But it did turn into, like, you know, doing paintings of the board graphics and just went to like the fine art realm, you know, kind of like naturally, like it just floated in there. I didn't try or anything.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's something to that, to just kind of like being in it and seeing where it takes you.
Yeah.
And sometimes that's hard for us. We want to feel like we have everything planned out or whatever.
No, I didn't have nothing planned out. The only thing I had planned, like, it was in my head that this was going to go somewhere regardless of what anyone said or made me, or how they made me feel. So my plan was just kind of like, it wasn't like a laid out plan. It wasn't like day to day or year to year. It was just like, it's going to work no matter what, you know what I mean? It has to. Yeah.
The flow.
The flow on the flow for sure.
And so looking at your art now, like, I don't know if I would even pick you for a skateboard guy.
Right.
So
that was a long time ago.
Yeah, I mean, maybe talk about that evolution. Was that, you know...
The style that I do now?
Yeah, like, how did the style evolve from making skate decks?
I just, like, started doing it one day.
Is that right?
I was working full-time at Deluxe Skateboards by this time. Okay. I left Santa Barbara and moved to... San Francisco and was hired by, you know, Deluxe, which is real Shorties. It was real Thunder, Spitfire, you know, Lucky 40s. Mm-hmm. All the skateboard companies under that umbrella. And so I, you know, was kind of, I was there for about 3.5 years, and I don't know, this style just came to me, and I just started doing it. I started painting. It was real rough. Looks a little different than it does now. It was mostly just lines, but it essentially still looks the same. And I just started doing it, dude, and I did a little art show, and it just kind of, you know, just kind of just left skateboarding because of that. You know, like, leave it. I still use that style in some board graphics once in a while, but for the most part, I left having to clock in because of that style of art that I had invented, basically.
Yeah. As far as making that transition, did somebody help you with that, or you kind of just did it on your own?
I think I just kind of did it on my own. Like, I had my friends who helped me because I put them in the art show with me, like Mark Gonzalez and Tommy Guerrero, Mickey Reyes. These are like big names. Jeremy Fish. These guys are all, you know, huge influences. And I figured if I just put myself with these guys, then that's who I am. Sure. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So.
No, that's big. I mean, we talk about that. Yeah. Me and Eddie talk about all that all the time. Just the importance of crews.
Yeah. My loose plan was just to align myself with the right dudes, basically, you know. I just kind of nudge in there. My friend told me once, get in where you fit in, and I really took that.
Who told you that, Danny?
Yeah, I think it, no, it was way earlier than Danny. But someone's like, get in where you fit in, and like, you know, I just took that to heart. That was like a long ass time ago. This was like probably like 90. I don't know, 2 or 3, bro.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Old school.
For sure. How much do you keep up with skate culture now?
Oh, I do a lot right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. They hit me up. The Olympic team hit me up.
Okay.
They wanted to do a group photo in front of one of my murals for the Olympics, for the team. I think they're still doing that. I heard about it, and I haven't seen much from it yet, but, you know, I figured that's usually how it goes.
You feel being in the Olympics is amazing for the sport. You feel like the culture has lost anything, you know, as it becomes more mainstream, or is it, or like, how does all that fit together?
I don't think it loses anything because there's always going to be that, the street kids in skateboarding, you know what I mean? You're going to have the Olympic team, but you're never going to get rid of the fucking neighborhood skateboarders. I mean, you know what I mean?
Sure.
And all gathering around the 7-Eleven and like all fucking on, just doing the same shit we've always done all these years. You know, I've seen it firsthand all the time. I just think it's just splintering into different aspects, but it's not changing anything.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Okay.
I just, you know, like the Olympics, then you got X Games, and you got Street League, and you got like all these other like pro contests who offer these huge amounts of money, and pros like Nyjah are, you know, they're like got big mansions and cars, and he rips. He deserves all that shit. Sure. You know, like, it's just changed. It's just evolving. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it stays to its true roots because it has to. That's where Nyjah came from, was the streets. And you know what I mean? It's like it has to come from the streets. So it's always going to maintain that street aspect for sure. I think.
For you guys that operate in a street art medium, you know, what does that mean when people aren't going out and seeing art? They're not, you know.
Too soon to tell.
Yeah.
We'll see, man. I don't think anything's going to change, to be honest with you.
Okay.
I mean, people are going to be like, it's contained. Oh, it's more contained. And then, it's safe to go back. You know, they're back in China where it originated. They're back in business.
Yeah, back in business. Or they're
on the streets, walking around with their umbrellas. Everyone's got face masks on, but nothing's closed down. The stores aren't closed down.
Yeah.
You know, we're in the early stages, and I know we have to contain it and keep it, you know, keep it away, like spreading like all the fucking over the place. But I mean, we got this, dude. We got this for as far as like if it's a real threat and like containing it and managing it, we got this as far as a country. country. You know what I mean? We're like advanced country. We're just, everyone's kind of far apart from each other here. I'm way out in the fucking country right now. I'm like literally an hour from Los Angeles.
You live in, you're in Ojai?
Ojai, yeah.
Okay.
You know Ojai?
Yeah, I know Ojai Valley Inn.
Yeah, man, that's my spot. Beautiful, you guys, we should go hang out there or something sometime. Hell yeah.
Get a massage.
Get a massage, drink beer, fucking play a round of golf.
I'm down for that.
What's up with Deer Lodge?
Oh, that's my homegirl owns that, dude.
Steve Edelson.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. You know Steve Edelson, right, Josh?
I did my first club in his building.
Yeah, me too. It's kind of crazy.
Glam Slam, I lost a lot of money.
I did Dragonfly.
Oh, yeah. I should have started small. I mean, not that Dragonfly was small. It was a dope spot. But we try to do too much. Story of my life.
Trying to do too much.
So, too
many people.
What about being out there in nature? Does that affect your art at all?
It's like, I don't know. I feel it's like harder to get to out here.
Mm.
Like harder to sit down and paint because I don't know. It's so beautiful. I want to go fucking hike and like go ride my bike. Like,
yeah.
I got a daughter now. She's like a year and a half. So like, you know, playing with her a lot is taking a bite out of doing a lot of paintings. But
of course,
I mean, my shit's all lined up for the year. So I know what I got to do and where I got to be at what time, you know? So in between those big projects, you know, like I like to do paintings. But right now, I'm just hanging out with my daughter and just enjoying nature. It's kind of a little harder to get to it, I feel, like, out here because, I don't know, you wake up, it's like, start something, like, oh, shit. And sometimes we have an acre out here, right?
Oh, wow.
And my studio is 5,000 square feet. So there's always fucking, that might be a bad thing, actually. It's always something to do around here. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, the other day, it was raining like cats and dogs, dude, and the fucking water just started pouring in through the back of the building.
Crazy.
So we're like, fuck, man, we got to fucking get this shit out of here. So it was like 3 hours of fucking, you know, fixing that fucking mess. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, of course.
Filling up the hole and doing all kinds of shit.
So can you see it in the art when, you know, obviously your art is a reflection of you, right? So, you know, you have a daughter, you're out in the country. Like, can you see the impact of that on the work?
Yeah, it's cleaner.
Is that right?
My art is cleaner because I'm taking, like, my paintings are like how I want them to be.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They're cleaner, they're tighter, I think, because I could take my time with it. There's like, I feel like when you slow down, like you slow everything down. You know what I mean?
Sure.
Because I still have my house downtown, so I'm still back and forth. And I could just, you know, as soon as we come out to Ojai and post up, it's like, I don't know. It just, everything just gets a little finer, a little slower. So yeah. I'm always feel like I'm rushing my paintings in LA. And when I'm here, I feel like I'll walk away from it for a few days. Just, you know, walk back just to do one little line. You know what I mean? So
that's funny. Yeah. I can notice that when I go, I always think if I go on vacation, if I'm on the beach or, you know, up in the mountains, like I'm going to get creatively inspired. To me, it's kind of the other way. It's like, I got to be in it, you know, on the grind, hearing the city and all that. And that's like what inspires my ideas.
I think I get inspired by the city and then I come out here and execute them.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a good balance. So, you're known for painting a lot of, you know, famous people. You had the Icon series, you know, Bob Marley, Beethoven, you know, these legends. How do you decide? What's that creative process like as far as deciding who you want to paint?
Sometimes it has to do with just a client commission.
Yeah.
Like, hey, will you paint Bob Marley on my building? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Oh, hell yeah, I'll do that. Sometimes it works out just great like that. And as far as me choosing, it's just what I'm feeling at the time, how what I'm listening to, what I'm grooving with, what, like, you know what I mean? What makes sense for me to paint, I feel.
Yeah. You know? You find that if listening to certain music, that impacts your art?
I think so. Equally as many people that I've done portraits of are other artists.
Sure.
Like, you know, just Andy Warhol, just all the basics, you know, like Jean-Michel Basquiat and Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera, all these other artists, like, because I'm feeling inspired by them at the time. So I go, hey, I'll do their portrait, kind of to pay homage kind of thing. It doesn't get any deeper than that with me, you know. It's like, it looks dope. Yeah. I like it. Paint it. Done. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I like that. No need to overthink it.
Mm-mm.
What, Eddie, you want to talk about the aqueduct project?
Yeah. Said, how was painting aqueduct?
It was miserable, but I loved the job because it was the aqueduct, and you know, that's the track where Secretariat debuted and retired at that track.
Right? Oh wow.
Most winning horse of all time, and that's the horse we painted with this jockey. I forget his name. I know it wasn't David Flores, but there's a famous horse jockey named David Flores, but he's not the one who rode Secretariat. Yeah, he was at the aqueduct though.
So why was it miserable?
It was cold. Mm. I had the flu basically, or some version of that, and then I gave it to Olivia, and she had it, and so we had, and that was like on our second day we came down with that shit. So we had to paint for in the freezing rain and wind for like 7 days, like just with the, basically it was just the flu, mm-hmm. you know.
Damn.
Yeah. And we like stayed in this little hotel, like right down from there, in this little Motel 6. And we get up at 7 a.m. and like just drag our feet to the aqueduct, like we're here, like get up on the boom, just start painting, like, you know what I mean?
Sure.
And that scale of painting is so big that you don't really feel like you're painting something, because you're painting these giant blue patches, mm-hmm. giant gray patch, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? And it's such a big piece that you don't really see it until you walk away from stand across the fucking parking lot from it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. What is it about? I mean, you know, a lot of your pieces are huge.
Yeah.
I was checking out the Helping Hand piece in Portland,
mm-hmm.
which is, I love that. And I think sometimes it's like the scale of it just, you know, it impacts you more.
Mm-hmm.
What is it about that to you that makes you want to do the really large format stuff?
Probably ego, bro. Probably okay. Just want it to be seen. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's probably it. I don't know. Yeah. I haven't thought about it. I just accept the challenge, basically. If someone says, hey, we have an 8-story building in Portland, you want to come paint it? All right. Shit. And then we figure out how to do it. Once we get there, kind of thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How to do it? What do you mean in terms of like lifts and all that stuff?
Well, that stuff's usually set up beforehand, but I'm talking about like the approach. Like, okay. We're gonna project it. How are we gonna go from top to bottom, or we're gonna go from, you know what I mean? Like, just how to do it.
Yeah.
What's the like? Because I know when other people paint, they have their like. Almost like their recipe, like their, you know what I mean? Like, they'll use stencils and it'll just be like a whole team goes up and goes brat and prints it out and then they're done, right?
Okay.
This shit is like different. It's like we gotta like project it, go up on a fuck, do the whole thing, project first, right? Mm-hmm. First, the whole thing gets black spray paint lines. So I already touched the whole wall on the first night, you know what I mean? And then we got to go back up and just come down with all the color, like a printing machine, you know what I mean? And then it's like, then come down with the fill. So basically I touched the wall like 3 times in the same spots throughout the whole piece, 3 or 4 times. And sometimes, you know, sometimes it's, you start at the bottom, sometimes you start at the middle and go out, sometimes top to bottom, it just all depends, you know? Mm-hmm. Sometimes you do the background first. Sometimes the building will already be painted the background color you want to use. You don't have to fuck with that. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like that building was painted that gray that I used for the background.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
And if I can do that, I will.
Yeah, it makes it easier, right?
Yeah. Why roll an extra like whole layer of paint? You know, just use the existing color into your design.
Yeah. So have you had a point like, is, I imagine like work just comes to you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Pretty much.
Was there a moment when that kind of tipped, when you were like chasing things, or were you ever chasing things?
I think the time when I moved to LA, when I first moved to LA, it's like Be There was like kind of the time of chasing. You know what I mean? Like, we're going to start doing murals. Whatever we do now, it was the time, it was during the recession. Remember that, 2008?
Yeah, of course.
I was like, whatever we build in this recession from the ground up, is when we get out of this recession, it's going to be huge. It's going to be big, and it's going to last for a long time. So we build it when we're down here on the ground. And you know what I mean? And I felt like everyone was kind of chasing into that time. You know what I mean? And so I said, here's what we're going to do. We're just going to go, and we're going to take my work, even existing stuff I've already done, we're just going to put it up big everywhere. And that's what we did.
Amazing.
Yeah. It was a conscious decision to like, to go big.
Sure. Yeah. And is that what, I assume you talk to young artists kind of starting out. Is that the kind of advice you give them? Is it like,
I tell them to just make so much shit you can't be ignored. That's my little go-to line for them right there. As I say, hey, make so much art that you can't be ignored. Whether it's music, if it's paintings, if it's murals, whatever you're into, make so much of it that you can't be ignored. Someone's going to hear it at some point. If it's good, you're going to be hitting. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's great advice.
You don't even have to be good. As long as you have a lot. You know, what's that one sign? The work sells itself if you have enough of it, you know? Like. Take it to heart. It really does.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think sometimes people get too caught up. They get, you know, they get afraid that their stuff's not good enough or they're not ready or whatever.
Yeah. Or they're trying to like launch some like big thing and like it's in their head that people give a shit. Like, you know what I mean? Right.
Yeah.
I know people like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And then what about collab? I know you collaborate with a lot of brands.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I saw your G-Shock and the Swarovski dogs.
Yeah.
What are the brands that you think are doing the best job making a contribution to art?
Whatever brands pay the most money. I did a collaboration with Li Ning, and I got canceled for that because I did a portrait of a Chinese Hong Kong protester.
Oh shit.
Yeah, and I posted it and it was just a portrait. There's the gas mask. It's up on my Instagram right now. You can see it. And I had a $250,000 deal with Li Ning and they canceled the whole thing. Right?
Man.
And that's fine because they paid me like half of it out and I was like kind of bummed, but at the same time I was like, man, if they don't understand the fucking art, then fuck them. I don't care. You know what I mean?
Right.
I wasn't trying to make some like point. I was just saying, yo, this is what's going on in the world today, you know? Sure. That's it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, obviously art and politics and you know, commerce and those things always crash into each other, right?
Yeah. And they caught wind of it. They saw it on my Instagram and they like had some big internal, I didn't know about this till like the next day. And they're like, they had some big meeting about it and they asked me to take it down. And I was like, no, I'm not going to take it down. I don't understand. Like, what's the big deal? You know what I mean? I'm not saying I didn't promote it. I didn't go against it. I just, here's the image. You know what I mean?
Right. Sure.
And they just, dude, they're just controlled by fear over there, man. Every single one of those people at that leaning office was just fucking petrified because I was their new artist. And I was like citing, I was on Hong Kong side during the whole, you know, Hong Kong demonstrations.
Sure.
And so they canceled it. We did a whole series and they canceled the second series of stuff we're going to do. We already had a whole year's worth of shit come out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was the second year that I was like, we're going to move into shoes and we're going to move into backpacks and all this other stuff and all this like streetwear shit. I wasn't even sure I wanted to do that, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. So when it got canceled, I was kind of like a little relieved. I was like, okay, good. Because this is a Chinese contract, dude. They're, you know what I mean? They don't always fucking stand by the contracts. That's all.
Are there other brands that you think really, really get the culture and are, I mean, obviously you come from skate world where those brands, they live in it.
I think a lot of brands are just stepping up to the plate right now. Yeah. And like, you know, like a lot, like Futura is doing something with BMW right now. Like car brands, auto manufacturers, like clothing line, you know, high end, like Louis Vuitton is always, you know, they're always pushing the envelope as far as like collaborating with artists, you know?
Yeah.
Like they're kind of like one of the first big fashion brands I saw doing like, you know, Murakami and all this other like labeled stuff. And
sure.
And, you know, I think companies like that are helping to promote it. They're doing pretty good with it. But all kinds, like Nike does a real, they've hired me a bunch, you know what I mean?
For
like,
sure.
All kinds of different brands. This just depends, you know? It just even the small companies, you know, everyone's just kind of on board right now with the whole art thing. And it just, it really helps the artists a lot. It really does.
Yeah, I mean, I think it helps the culture too, right? Because, you know, we don't want to buy shit. We want to buy shit from the people that we know and love. And, you know, we want art in our lives every day.
Yeah, it's crazy because I feel like with the internet now, like everyone knows everyone now. You know what I mean? Like everyone knows what everyone's doing. And it's like, I don't know. It's just everyone's kind of connected. And it's being kind of discover people and artists a lot easier now than I used to be able to, you know? And even get to know people. I just shoot my shot with Damien Hirst. I just throw a fucking thing in his DM. I'm like, dude, I love these new paintings you're doing. And he hit me back. You know, dude, I'm talking to Damien Hirst, like, on DM. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's amazing.
Even though it's just a little DM, like, chit-chat, it's still...
Still.
How was you able to talk to Damien Hirst back in the day? You couldn't. Or never. Fucking... It's like talking to Pablo Picasso. You know what I mean? Like, you can't. You know what I mean? Like back in the day, you were far away. You couldn't meet that motherfucker. You had to like make an appointment and shit. You had to be someone. Now it's just like, hey, the DMs got me in there.
Yeah, absolutely. I do it too. I hit people up all the time. It's like, you want to know each other? You know,
dude, I DM with the wildest people. Patty Hearst, you know, Patricia Hearst.
Is that right?
Yeah, like her, fucking Wayne Brady. Me and Wayne Brady fucking talk shit all the time.
What are you and Patty Hearst talking about?
She shows French bulldogs.
Okay.
So mainly about French bulldogs and dogs and my daughter. She loves my daughter and just
nice.
I'm afraid to bring up anything with her. Like, hey man, tell me about the days when you robbed a bank. Like, I'm like, I don't want to like scare her away. I guess you know what I mean.
Sure.
She might being be too to... curious. I think it's kind of
she
keep
might be
it
trying to leave her past in the past.
Yeah, like if we keep it on the surface with just things that are going now, I think we can, you know, cultivate a beautiful friendship.
Nice. Mm-hmm. So what are you most excited about next? What are you working on?
Man, I'm doing a big mural for a really big company in La Jolla. Irvine, in the next couple months. It's a really big deal because it's going to be the biggest mural I've done so far.
Oh, cool.
Probably one of the biggest companies, too, as far as, like, financially is concerned.
Nice.
And got the studio we're building. We're building a house in the back. We're building a gallery in the back. Like, just busy around here, you know?
Dope.
Yeah.
Are the bikes, is that a business or that's for you?
This is just my, like, my man cave kind of thing. Yeah. Like, it's just like a container, you know, a shipping container.
Oh, that's cool.
And I just turned it into a bike shop, basically. But it's not really, but nothing's for sale.
You're not selling bikes.
Like, nah, it just looks like a bike shop, but it's like my bar, my hangout,
that's cool.
My breakfast spot.
You go ride, you ride in the mountains up there?
Yeah. Which I did a ride yesterday at Point Magoo.
Oh, nice.
Little ascend out there. It was fun.
Yeah.
Trails are so nice right now, nice and tacky.
Yeah.
Just they like clay. The tires just wrap right on the brakes, just holding on. It's fun. I like going fast.
That's cool. Love it.
Yeah,
love it. All right, I gotta do a little lightning round before I let you.
Okay.
Get on with your day. What's your favorite city to travel to?
Tokyo, Japan.
Yeah, I love it there. Mm-hmm. You paint there?
Yeah, I painted Parker Museum.
Oh, cool.
2014, painted the whole outside.
Nice.
It was during what's called Golden Week when everyone gets all fucked up, drunk. So we painted these Smurf death heads that were just all fucking drunk all over the place. It was fun.
That's so. That's so. Yeah, I mean that city is like bursting with art and just creativity, right?
All the time. That's right. That's where most of my inspiration came from, and I've never been more accepted than I have in that damn city. You know?
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
That's cool. I don't know if you're a reader. What's the last great book you read?
I don't read, dude.
Okay. You paint.
I paint. What's the last book you read? I can't even.
Is that right?
Children's books. I read a shitload of those now.
Yeah, of course. That's actually good because a lot of us have kids. What's one that you actually can enjoy reading?
Oh, there's one. There's these little, I forgot the name of them, but they're like, they're artists' lives, like Frida Kahlo, Pablo Picasso.
Oh, yeah.
Kind of condensed down into children's stories. You know what I mean? Real simple.
We had a couple of those when my son was young, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The Life of Frida, The Life of Pablo.
That's right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I remember we had the Obama one. They had like different.
The Life of Obama.
Yeah. What movie have you seen the most in your life?
Point Break.
Oh, shit.
The original Patrick Swayze.
Yeah.
Nah, when they're fucking robbing the banks and shit in masks.
It's a good movie.
Yeah.
If you could wake up tomorrow having gained any quality or ability, what would it be?
Probably to be in like really good shape.
Okay. And last one, if I worked for you, what's something I would hear you say over and over?
Let's take a smoke break, bro. Let's take a smoke break.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, dude, Dave Flores, I appreciate you, man. It was great talking to you.
Thank you.
Definitely let me know when you're down in L.A. Or we have to get up to Ojai and hit some golf balls for sure.
When you're up here, please give me a call, man. My studio is open. And that's what it's for. It's going to be a huge art gallery, art studio. And when people come to Ojai, this could be an option. Just come by and check out the studio. You know what I mean? Because I'm going to show different artists here, all kinds of shit.
Dope. Well, everybody, make sure you check out Dave Flores Art. Is that right? On Instagram?
Yep.
And
Dave Flores Art. DaveFloresArt.com. And that's it.
Nice. We'll be watching for what's next.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, that was David Flores and Eddie Donaldson on Rebel Radio. I hope you enjoyed it. I know I did. Tell us what you think. Hit us up on Twitter, on Facebook. You can shoot me a note on YouTube. You can follow us on Instagram, whatever you like. Pretty much everything is at Rebel Radio Net. That's Rebel Radio Net. And most importantly, come back next week for more Rebel Radio. Peace.